Hello, welcome to the Halloween edition of Level 20 Sportsline. We're at the Level 20 as always. We're getting ready to start off with what's on your mind. I'm Mike Migliori, Chip Hayner, Smoking Jim Frazier, and Al Levine. Al, what's on your mind?
What's on my mind is, well, the rain right now, but we'll forget about that and go to sports. First of all, Pitt had a nice game. I don't even know who they were playing, but they did well. Tino Cinceri had another good game. So it shows he can play against the lesser teams, which is a good thing with Pitt. They don't have to worry about that offense or who's playing. Ray Graham set a record, passed Shady McCoy. This mask is a little restrictive here.
Take it off.
I don't want to. Okay. Hey, Troy, you can have the mask. Troy Polamalu's checking in with us. And then, of course, the Steelers had a win, so I have to touch on a couple things there. It was a nice game to see them. They say they shut down RG3, but I think all those drops sort of shut him down because he did one of the worst things you can do whenever you pass the ball. You hit guys in the hands, and that's a terrible thing when you need some people to hold on to the ball. So that's some of my observations and what's on my mind.
Thanks, Al. Smoking Jim, what's on your mind?
Thanks, Magic Mike. Has anybody ever seen Houdini and Big Ben in the same place at the same time? Big Ben again yesterday worked his magic. I tell you what, Big Ben threw for 3 touchdown passes, 2 to 2 separate tight ends, and 1 to 1 fullback. And I tell you what, he's bringing physicality back to the Steeler Nation, and that's why he gets one of my game balls. The other game ball has to go to Downtown Antonio Brown, who proves he can run backwards faster than most guys in the NFL can run forward. My third game ball has to go to the legendary coach, Dick LeBeau. Before the game, everybody says Dick LeBeau needs to retire at 75, that he lost his fastball. Well, I tell you what, he pitched a shutout against the Washington Redskins. And finally, my last game ball has to go to running back Jonathan Dwyer. He was the first Steeler running back to go back-to-back 100-yard games since Fast Willie Parker did it in 2007. And in fact, I believe Rashard Mendenhall will be tweeting about that.
Thanks, Jim. Chip, what's on your mind?
Jim, you are one heck of a hard act to follow. I'll do my best. What's on my mind? The BCS, once again. Can we make this just go away? After a great weekend of college football, there's 4 teams left now that actually have a chance to vie for the national title. Well, let's make that 3 teams, because there's one team that's undefeated, that steamrolled its opponent 70-14 or whatever the final score was. It's not going to get a chance to play for the national title this year. And the logic behind not giving them a chance to play for the national title is because 2 of their upcoming opponents lost last weekend as well. I don't see how that makes any logic, but USC lost to Arizona, and they are an upcoming opponent of the Oregon Ducks. The Oregon Ducks have been running all over everybody, and I saw one of the most amazing run backs on the highlight reel from the Oregon game. The kid, I don't think anybody on the field, everybody on the field missed him, but he was absolutely amazing. Alabama's still ranked number 1, okay? They're ranked number 1 in every poll. That makes sense. Oregon's ranked number 2 in every poll. Kansas State is ranked number 3, and Notre Dame's ranked number 4. When you go to the BCS, Kansas State is ranked number 2 behind Alabama. Notre Dame leapfrogged Oregon because Notre Dame beat Oklahoma this week. And somehow Oregon doesn't seem to make any progress, and somehow this seems to make sense in the BCS. I hate the BCS. I wish it would go away. They need to find a better system to judge the national championship in college and give more teams the opportunity to vie for the championship. The playoff system that they're going to institute in 2014 is going to be inadequate and be just as big as a mess as what they've got now. But that's what's on my mind, Mike.
Thanks, Chip. Jim, you are absolutely right. For those of you that don't know who Houdini is, he was an escape artist and a magician. They used to lock him up in a cell, and he'd escape. Just like Roethlisberger should be in a cell, but he's not. So, Jim, you're absolutely right. And, Chip, you want to talk about a mess. The BCS is a terrible mess. But what about the NHL? The owners gave a pretty good deal to the players, a 50-50 split. Where I come from, 50-50 is fair. But the players, they don't like that split. The players want a 57%, and now, today, they canceled the entire November season. All the games in November are gone. Now all we got left is December. Pretty soon they're going to cancel that. They're going to cancel the winter game. They're going to cancel the All-Star game. And on January 1st, they're going to cancel the season.
Wow.
You know what you need to do? Somebody needs to get rid of Donald Fehr. He ruined baseball. Now he's going to ruin hockey. And who knows where he'll go from there. But the NHL cannot survive another year without a season. You guys better come up with something. And that's it.
Absolutely agree with you.
I absolutely disagree. The players, think about it. You're talking owners that, what, they cried about losing $100 million to try to get weak-minded people to believe that. They also polarized everybody, and the union's not really a union. They tried to protect all the superstars. That's why they put a 50-50 deal. Anybody that read what they offered, it would actually be fair because you would keep the salaries that you had. They drew a line in the sand, the owners, and they said, go ahead, let's see if you blink. Like I told a couple guys on the panel, nobody's blinking on this. The owners got the gold, so he who has the gold rules.
What does that mean?
You're too smart of a man not to be able to figure that out. You just made your statements and all that stuff. It's very simple. They don't want to have a season. They want to try to break them. Guess what? Next year, all the players you like will still be in a union, and they'll work something out.
They should break the union. What they should
they
do
will
is
not
they should,
break the union.
They should put the tell the players that are under contract, we're going to have a season. We're not going to negotiate with the union. We're going to play our games. If you come back and play, we'll pay you. If you don't, we'll fire you, and we'll replace them with other players. Every one of these teams has minor league teams they can pull people up with, and hockey's hockey. You might not get Sidney Crosby. You might not get Zach Parise for a while, but you know what? They're not making $8.5 million and $10 million anywhere else. They'll come back. They'll cross. The union will be broken if they do it that way.
I'll take a dollar bet on that.
Instead, shut up till I'm done talking.
No, you try to be ignorant about unions all the time, and you love the players that are in unions.
Have destroyed the country. Labor unions have destroyed the United States. Players unions
destroyed
baseball.
See, he's talking political here. You got people that have unions and are proud of them.
You can listen to this idiot, or you can watch and see what happens. You're not going to have hockey this year because of morons like that.
And
Jim, what happened on Sunday?
Think about it.
How did the Steelers do what they did?
Well,
aside from a bunch of drop balls.
Well, yeah.
Do they have any union players in the football league?
Well, that's
did you guys watch?
Well, that's one thing. You know, I thought that the Steelers had a great opportunity to be victorious against Washington Redskins for a couple of reasons. One, Dick LeBeau is almost perfect against rookie starting quarterbacks. Number two, it's hard in the National Football League in this day and age with the players now for them to play back-to-back road games and play very well. You know, Washington Redskins should have beat the Giants in New York, but playing back-to-back road games, favorite the home team, and then the bad weather. Temple beat up on the field, and Pitt beat up on the Heinz Field the day before. It was bad weather conditions, along with the 10 drop passes, and it was tailor-made for the Pittsburgh Steelers and Magnificent Seven, Big Ben Roethlisberger.
Well, you know, being that the Steelers have now won two games in a row, everything's all rosy in the Steeler Nation. But, you know, here's the thing about the Steeler game yesterday. They did play a nice defensive game. I don't know so much if they shut down RG3. One thing RG3 has shown me, he's got a lot of poise for a rookie quarterback. And I think he's going to do very well in the league. There was a lot of drops in the game, and I don't, you know, some of those were the result of good defensive play. Some of them, you know, just bad receivership. Now, you know, the Steelers yesterday, they rushed for 140 yards, okay? So it's two games in a row they've rushed for over 100 yards, and that seems to be the recipe for their success. Todd Haley's offense, he's playing a ball control offense, and, you know, as long as the Steelers can keep the opposing quarterback off the field, they've got a much better chance at winning. What I think is really going to be the test this weekend is that the Steelers are going to go up against Eli Manning. Eli Manning is every bit as good as Ben Roethlisberger is. I'd say they're two of the elite quarterbacks in the league. He can win games, in the last minute, and he's got the confidence to do it. But he's got the receiver core that's not going to drop as many balls. The Steelers defense, I think, will not have a problem shutting down the Giants' rush. But the thing that I want to find most interesting is, what is the Steelers' offensive line going to do against the Giants' defensive line? They're actually going to be playing against a defensive line that's a real threat. And we'll see how well the defensive line or the O-line plays this week.
Well, hold on 1 second. I tell you what, before you guys go, my man Magic Mike, who's a movie producer, you got a brother for your actor, man. One of the best Black actors this side of Denzel Washington got to be Keenan Lewis on that fake interception. He's chest bumping. The replacement refs gives him an interception. I was fooled. I thought he was another Houdini till they showed it on instant replay. Mike, you got a brother for your next movie, an actor.
It's going to be a horror film. And you know how long he's going to live. Because like you say all the time, in a horror film, the bro must go.
And Chip, on your point with the offensive line, they do a great job of blocking and tackling, so that helps. They've continued that theme. And look, they have a 100-yard runner who's like a little bus. Well, they keep it up. So, I mean, that's part of what they're doing. You got Max Starks falling on top of guys, and that helps. So, I mean, I think that they can hold the defensive back just with what they keep doing. For some reason, the refs aren't calling those penalties every week. Maybe they got the word, you can't call them every week on the Steelers. Spread it around a little bit. So we'll think about
look what they do. Another thing the Steelers defense did on this past weekend is the Redskins had the number one rushing offense in football. They were averaging 170 yards a game. Mm-hmm. And the Steelers gave up 86 yards rushing for the game yesterday. And that seems to me like the Steeler defense of old, not the old defense that everybody keeps on complaining about.
And look go ahead.
It seemed like every time that Washington ran the ball, they gashed the Steelers pretty well. They just didn't try to do it very often. They didn't run at all. That guy Morris is a great running back. Mm-hmm. Griffin never really tried to run the ball too much. Speaking of which, first, let me help you out with something. Eli Manning was every bit as good a quarterback as Ben Roethlisberger is now when he was in junior high school.
Mm-hmm.
So you can count. And again, the only thing the Steelers have going for them next week is that Tom Coughlin's job is not in jeopardy yet. When they lose enough games, they start talking about firing him. Giants will win for the rest of the season, as they always do. A lot of drop passes yesterday. One thing I'll say for Griffin is that he can really do a play fake. He had the Steelers linebackers running around in circles with his play fakes yesterday.
Yes, he did.
The biggest problem is none of the receivers could hold on to the ball. Thank God he's not Cam Newton, because he'd still be talking about they need to put better players around him.
And that's one thing about RG3 is that after the game, he did not throw his players under the bus. You know, he talked about it like we're a team. You know, we have to get better. You listen to Cam Newton. Cam Newton's pointing fingers, and it's everybody else's fault but his. And that's the difference between a class act and a clown act.
You're saying a black quarterback can play fake. That's like saying he can sing and dance. We already know that.
But he did a nice job yesterday. And part of the reason why they couldn't run as much is for some reason we scored on the four series that we had, the first four, which how many times did the Steelers do it? And then we all know, we've seen it before, when they have the ball control offense, whether it's a dink and dunk or it's a run like Jerome Bettis, you control the ball, so you control your destiny, and that seems to be what's happening in their game plan. So Todd Haley's pulling the bubble screen out every so often. He loves Heath Miller. Matter of fact, Ben wants him to run for president. So he's his campaign manager.
Well, I'll tell you what, Ben should want Todd Haley to run for president, because if you noticed that Ben's uniform is clean at the end of the day, didn't get sacked once. And I'll tell you one thing that Todd Haley's offense is doing, it's protecting our greatest asset on offense.
Well, that's true. Jim, last week you told us that Heath Miller was the third leading receiver in Steelers history.
Yes, sir.
Yesterday looked like he was making a strong push for number two. He's catching the ball all the time. He's a very good receiver. I wouldn't be surprised to see him line up at receiver.
And I don't see too many tight ends that are able to flank out like a receiver. That's amazing. He's able to do that.
And then Mike Wallace, all of a sudden, he only dropped one really one real pass, and he looked like a possession receiver. What was he doing going over the middle, getting hit like that and holding on to the ball? So he stepped up a little bit.
It seemed like Mike Wallace was a little bit grumpy after the game. I heard an interview with him, and, you know, they were talking about him being the focus of the offense, that they were targeting him so much, and he doesn't seem to feel like he's a part of the offense. I think Mike Wallace, in his own mind, is already out of here, and he's just playing out the season. You know, I think Mike Wallace could be doing a lot better, and I don't know if he's upset that he's not getting thrown the deep ball, but you know what? What matters is wins and losses, and the way they've been playing the last 2 weeks, they keep on putting up the W's. I mean, personal statistics will suffer, but isn't it about the team?
What you were hearing was that Mississippi education.
Well, here, he had eight catches the week before, and he had seven. So, I mean, it doesn't take much intelligence to figure out you had 15 catches. Who else caught 15 balls in the last two games for the Steelers?
I think you have to expect Mike Wallace to be grumpy probably for the rest of the season, because being part of the Young Money squad there, bothering him that he's gone, because of his holdout, he's gone from fast money to no money, and Antonio Brown's gone from Young Money to Mike's money. And that's you know, probably weighing on him a lot. But the Steelers receivers corps is probably as good as anybody else is in the in the league. The fact that they're only 4-3 probably lays to the fact that they have a poor quarterback. But you know, if those three guys were playing, say, in Denver or in New England or in the New York Giants, then you know, they'd probably be winning a lot more games. Speaking of New York. Isn't it time yet? Isn't it time yet? I mean, you know, I like Mark Sanchez. He's a good guy. He had enough sense to get rid of Eva Longoria after, you know, too long. But he's not really doing the job. It's time to put Tebow in and see what he can do. Rex Ryan is a bum. But, you know, eventually somebody's going to have to give him a phone call and say, Rex, someone put the other quarterback in before we fire you.
Well, you know what, and I think that Rex Ryan's job's more at stake now than Mark Sanchez's. And there's a couple of other head coaches, I think, whose necks are on the chopping block. You got Ron Rivera down there in Carolina, who's I don't think will make it to the end of the season. You got Andy Reid in Philadelphia. This looks like the Eagles are swirling the bowl right now, and they're thinking about benching Michael Vick. And I don't even know what I can't even remember the kid's name that they're
Foles.
Thinking about.
Foles.
Yeah, okay. Foles. But F-O-L-E. I mean, you know, he's in trouble. You got North Turner over in San Diego, and that guy must have tape on somebody because the Chargers have underachieved consistently for quite some time. But I mean, there's a number of coaches whose necks are on a chopping line, and I think you know Rex Ryan, you know, if he doesn't make the playoffs this year, I think he's going to be gone in New York.
Yeah, absolutely right. CBS Sportsline on the internet had a list of 9 coaches whose jobs are in jeopardy, and you know who's not on that list? Marvin Lewis.
Wow.
Marvin Lewis, who must be a civil servant or something, because there seems to be absolutely no way that this man could lose that job. So,
yeah. You know, he gets one good year followed by about a half a dozen of bad ones, you know, so they get this high draft picks. And, you know, because they draft character players there, right?
Quite the characters, Chip. Quite the characters.
The ball and chain gang.
Right.
Well, that's a pretty bold statement for a Steeler fan.
We're working on it. We're working on it.
Speaking of the Steelers criminals, Ta'amu now has been reactivated, no longer suspended by the team, ready to go ahead and play. This poor young man from a low-income type country comes in here, tries to make a living just because he gets a little bit crazy, you know, smashes up a few cars, injures a few people, fights with the police. That's absolutely no reason to not let him play football.
You know, before he got arrested, he never saw the field yet anyhow. So now that he's got his mugshot taken, I guess that'll get him into the starting lineup.
Now he's finally a Steelers-type player.
Maybe we'll go to the Super Bowl now. It happened with Ernie. Maybe they need to shave an arrow in his head.
Well, speaking of champions.
There you go.
We have an absolutely beautiful young lady as a guest today. She is a basketball player and volleyball player for Ambridge. They are going into the playoffs. Let's welcome Alyssa Dowds. Where's your mask, Alyssa?
I didn't get one.
I got a white one.
Well, thanks for coming. Why don't you tell us a little bit about your basketball and volleyball in Ambridge and the team and how they're doing.
Well, our volleyball team is great, and we are in the Woodfields right now for the playoffs, and this is our second round. But last year, our second round, we lost.
Oh, well, who are you playing this year?
We play Freeport.
Are they any good?
Yes, they are very good.
Okay. And so what position do you play?
I'm a middle hitter, so I'm right front on the net all the time.
All right, and you play basketball for them also?
Yes, I'm a forward, and this season's going to be real fun because we're playing in Disney.
Oh, okay, that'll be pretty fun.
Yeah.
In basketball, do you have to play against Hopewell?
Yeah.
They're good.
Yeah, they're really good. And Shatori Walker, yeah. She's one of their best players.
Yeah.
Yes.
We had her on a show?
No, not yet. She's a dash Kimborough. I know how you feel about the Kimborough.
Well, okay, yeah, you're right. Raquan Kimborough is very pretty, but he was one of the worst boxers to ever come out of the city and never wanted to fight anybody. But anyway, let's get back to Ambridge. So your next game is against Freeport. Is it like a one-and-done kind of thing, or is it a series of matches?
If we lose, we're out of it.
You lose, you're done.
Wow. Yes.
Okay. And who'd you play in the first round?
We played TJ, Thomas Jefferson, yeah. And we went all five matches. We lost the first two, and then we won the other ones. And then the third one, you can only go to 15 points, and we were both tied at 15. But then we won 17-15.
Well, that's good, because Thomas Jefferson should be in Quad A anyway.
Yeah.
They should be playing down there.
Yes, they should be. They should be.
Well, that's what they deserve. In volleyball, did you play against Montour at all? Because they're usually pretty good in volleyball.
No, we didn't play Montour this year.
All right. And for basketball, because then you play for basketball?
I'm a forward.
All right.
It sucks, because I'm the tallest one.
How tall are you?
I'm 5'10".
Wow, supermodel.
Yes. Is that without the heels?
Yeah, without the heels. With the heels, I'm like 6'4".
Wouldn't you like to be 6'4" on the court?
Sometimes. Sometimes it just makes me feel like freakish tall. I don't like that.
Not so freakish. Probably.
What's your favorite shot in basketball?
Right under the net. I like doing layups. They're
Do
fun.
You?
Yeah.
You
know, no 3-pointers.
180 dunks or whatever?
No, yeah. I'm not a jumper.
Easy smoking, Jim.
He's going to tell you why you can't jump.
Easy. He says we can't jump. Then okay. We don't play basketball nope. either. So.
In addition to the sports, Jim was right, you are a supermodel.
Yes.
Tell us what you've been doing recently as far as modeling.
Well, I just started like 2 months ago, and it's all happening really quick. First, I did a runway boot camp with Miyoshi Anderson, and then we had auditions for Pittsburgh Fashion Week, and I was lucky enough to get picked for opening night, and I modeled for Faith Pornogratz, and then the Saturday show, which is the back-to-back runway show, I modeled for the first designer. And as I was walking off stage, the second designer grabbed me and was like, I need you. And I was like, oh, okay. So I did that show, and then I had another show for Noah Fineout. She's a senior, and she is like starting off with her designs, and she's really good for just being a senior. Like, I'm only a junior, and I don't know how she does that. Like, I couldn't.
And you're 16 years old, right?
Yeah.
You got to get used to guys grabbing you and telling you they need you.
That's
going to happen a lot over the next 20-some years.
You just got to watch out. There's some crazy people.
Good point. You have some wisdom.
You're not a senior, you're a junior?
Yeah, I'm only a junior.
Oh,
I'm
we
got
to recruit her to the Gateway.
You still got time.
Oh, yeah.
You got the application for housing.
A few calls. I'll be putting you up in an apartment building in Gateway or in Monroeville so you can play at Gateway. It's a very usual practice there. It happens often. I'm surprised they haven't called you yet. But the modeling's going real well for you. The sports are going real well for you.
Last night I just had another show. It was for a Battle of Designers. That was really fun. It was at the William Penn.
Wow. That's a nice place.
It was so nice.
How many people were there?
I don't even know. The whole, like, ballroom was filled, and the runway was, like, the longest runway. It was fun.
That is a nice place.
Okay, now you've lived in Pittsburgh all your life, right?
Yeah.
So you know a little bit about the Steelers and stuff like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I just want to tell Jim.
Jim has stated repeatedly that Ben Roethlisberger is the greatest quarterback in
Steelers
history.
Ben Roethlisberger sucks. Oh, I'm sorry.
You're still welcome back. Oh, he just spit a fry out on me.
Oh, man. Oh, that was good. I didn't see that one.
I like the Tebow.
She likes Tebow. She
like
did the Tebow pose.
All right.
You brought yourself back in his good grace.
That was good.
All right. Well, you can stick around for a while if you like. We're going to let Chip bore us for about 15 minutes about the World Series.
I'm happy the Giants won. I was watching it. I knew they would win.
We all picked the
Giants. You know, I had made a prediction last week that Detroit was going to win in six games. And I tell you what, you got to tip your hat to the San Francisco Giants. They swept the Tigers. They did it in a commanding fashion. As a matter of fact,
I hate to interrupt you, but I don't want you to feel bad. Had it gone six games, they very well may have won, but it didn't.
No, it sure didn't. And I'll tell you what, I'll admit when I was wrong, and I guessed that one. I couldn't have been any more wrong. But the Giants did something that hasn't been done since 1966 in the World Series. The 1966, the Baltimore Orioles swept the Los Angeles Dodgers, and their team ERA for that series was 1.66. And the Giants' ERA for the series that just concluded last night was 1.52. That's a record that's never been done before in baseball. And if you've got a pitching staff that's that hot, I don't care who you're going up against, you're going to make them look bad. I mean, the Tigers really manhandled the Yankees. And I thought, wow, they were coming in with a pretty strong credentials. But the Giants are just never say die. They were faced elimination six times this year in the playoffs, and they couldn't be killed. You couldn't drive a stake through their heart, and they just kept on finding a way to win. And you got to tip your hat to Bruce Bochy and the San Francisco Giants. Congratulations.
You know what, the Tigers basically disappeared. I mean, triple Quan winner did absolutely nothing. Cecil Fielder did absolutely nothing. Mm-hmm. Their Cy Young winner, Verlander, got blown up in the first game. They had a long layoff. After they swept the Yankees and they had a long layoff, whereas the Giants went with a long series, a seven-game series against St. Louis. Do you think that layoff makes a difference if you get hurt?
I absolutely do think it made a difference. And the Tigers tried something different this year, because when they played in the series in 2006, they had another real long layoff, and they lost to the Cardinals that year. But, what they did was they brought up their one of their developmental teams from Florida, and they had them play a couple of simulated games like on Saturday and Sunday. But, the fact that they weren't facing live pitching and game-type situations, I think that did make a big, big difference in the way they performed. And I think, somebody like Verlander, if he would have had his normal amount of rest in between starts, he would have been a lot sharper on the mound. And there was just so long of a period of time that he was off. And, I think he's flattened out his pitches, and Pablo Sandoval put two of them into the seats. And he did something that's only been done by three other men in Major League history. One of them was Babe Ruth. The other one was Albert Pujols. And who was the third? They hit three. Reggie Jackson hit three home runs in one World Series game.
Mr. October.
Bobby Robertson from the Pirates.
Not in the series.
Not in the World Series.
No, three in one game. Okay.
Against Baltimore. Yes, he did.
Okay, I stand corrected. But that in and of itself was just an amazing thing to do in a World Series game, and doing it against Justin Verlander, who's arguably the best pitcher in baseball the last two or three years. And you lose big like that. Your ace loses real big, and they were looking to him to win at least a couple of games in the series, and he never got another chance to pitch.
Well, yeah. I got to admit that I picked Detroit. Jimmy Leland showed some class. He said, what can I say here? The better team won. They outplayed us. And that's what happened. Look at Sandoval and his hitting there. What was he, about 8 for 14 or something, Chip?
No, he was 8 for 16. He batted .500 for the series.
Wow. And, that's almost unheard of, too.
And then a guy that the Giants picked up at the trade deadline, Marco Scudero, they picked him up off the Colorado Rockies. He was the NLCS MVP in the seven-game series against the Cardinals. And he hit in the winning run last night in the top of the 10th inning. So, the trades that are made at the deadline can make a difference. The Giants picked the right card.
I was surprised that Lincecum was not the MVP. In like you said earlier, it was a, kind of a bull move to take him out of the rotation and put him into the bullpen. But out of the bullpen, he was extremely effective.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and over the last 3 or 4 years, he's been a Cy Young candidate. He won back-to-back Cy Young awards. But this year, he seemed to have his worst year as a professional. And he just didn't go any distance in any of his starts. And he was all over the place. And, you know, they took him out of the starting lineup, and they started putting him in long relief in the playoff games. And, man, it made such a big difference, because when their starting pitcher got roughed up and they had to take him out early, what a great guy to put in to get you 3 or 4 or maybe 5 innings when, you know, you've got relievers that most coaches won't let pitch more than one inning, you know. So it was somebody that was used to pitching more than an inning at a time, and it gave them some stability there. Didn't have to use up their bullpen early.
Well, I mean, we all picked Detroit, so I guess this is the Alyssa show.
That's right.
Why did you think San Francisco would win?
I don't really know much about them, but I mean, I just picked them.
Well, I'll tell you another thing.
She's too honest.
I know, like, Pirates and stuff. But
San Francisco's pretty.
I mean, I know what comes on Sportsline there because I watch that all the time, but besides that.
Well, that's just a lucky guess then.
Yeah.
Okay.
With all of our talk good about enough. The San Francisco Giants, you know, the one person that we haven't mentioned yet is who's going to be named the National League MVP soon. It's Buster Posey. He's the catcher for the Giants, and he will be the National League MVP this year. But, you know, in 2010, he was a rookie, and he was the spark plug that took San Francisco to the world title in 2010. Last year, there was that horrific collision at home plate that broke his leg, and he missed the whole season last year. So San Francisco doesn't make the playoffs. He's back this year, and he's a solid MVP candidate. He's probably the best catcher in baseball. And, you know, he handles the pitching staff. He won the National League batting title. The kid can do it all. He actually throws out runners trying to steal.
What's that like? I'm from Pittsburgh. What's that like?
Well, that's something that we don't
I haven't
see
noticed that in years.
Yeah, it's something that we don't see often.
Where?
Well, since the World Series was over yesterday, the free agency period starts today. The Pirates have 3 free agents: Jason Grilley, Qualls, and and the other pitcher that they put in the bullpen there, what's his name?
Anyway,
no, the other. Whatever his name is. Anyway, they got 3 pitchers that are free agents this year. Jason Grilley was the one I wanted to talk about anyway. He can pitch the 8th inning, only the 8th inning, but he can pitch the 8th inning. And only for 2 games in a row, then he has to have a rest. How much money will somebody like Jason Grilley make?
You know, that'll be interesting to see, but I don't see Jason Grilley getting a lot of money thrown at him. And, you know, simply because he had Tommy John surgery a couple of years ago, and he's in his mid-30s, and, you know, he's closer to the end of his career than he is at the beginning. He was real good for a short while, you know, this summer, but he seemed to lose his magic as we got into August and September, like, well, quite a number of the other pitchers in our staff.
Who didn't, Chip? Who didn't lose?
Quite a number of them. I mean, you know, you got to call a spade, and you know, the Pirates didn't perform well in August and September. That's well documented.
I think the only Pirates that didn't lose their magic were Clint Barmas and Rod Barajas, because they never had any to begin with. Everybody else folded up. The Pirates, again, they're in free agency. You don't really expect them to do anything.
You know what? I don't see them. You know, the biggest name out there in the free agent market's Josh Hamilton, and you know the Pirates are never going to pony up the kind of money that he's going to get. The Milwaukee Brewers are very interested in signing him, and you know, we may be seeing him come to PNC Park more frequently than we would like to this year. But you know, I don't really see the Pirates making a big noise in the free agent market. I don't know if there's anybody out there that would you know, fit in with the framework of what they got right now.
No, they do need some help here, Chip.
A couple hitters,
a couple pitchers, catcher maybe.
Absolutely, but you know, just because they have the money to spend doesn't mean that they need to go out there and spend it foolishly. They're going to think things through, and you know, make moves that make sense for now and in for the future. So,
but we're talking about Pirates, right?
Yeah,
they're not going to spend money foolishly. First, they don't spend money at all, but when they do, it's usually foolishly. What I'm thinking is they might get a pretty big name this year. Because if Alex Rodriguez is really finished, I'm sure the Yankees wouldn't mind paying half his salary and sending him here.
And I don't see Alex Rodriguez leaving leaving New York. You know, I see him staying, being the starting third baseman for the Yankees, playing right next to Derek Jeter next spring.
I don't know about Derek Jeter. That was a pretty rough injury.
It's a pretty rough injury, but I have a feeling that we'll see him back on the field.
I hope you're right. Hope you're right. Great player.
For baseball's sake, because he is, that is one gentleman that's playing right now that is a first ballot Hall of Famer without any question.
As much as I hate to say this twice in one show, Chip, you're absolutely right. University of Oregon should definitely be number two, if not number one, in the BCS. If they're undefeated and they don't play for a championship, it's a crime. They have rolled. I mean, they score 60 to 70 points
a game
every game,
and they even play defense, unlike the West Virginia Mountaineers.
I think that they would roll over the. I think they'd roll over Alabama. I think it would be a great game to watch, a lot of fun to watch. Personally, I would really like to see Kansas State and Oregon play.
Oh, that
because
would
be. That might be the highest scoring game in history.
And that quarterback from Kansas State, I think he's the odds-on favorite to win the Heisman right now. I think he's just amazing. You know, they who were they playing last week? They went down to them early, and then they put 55.
Texas Tech
was another point scoring machine, and they shut them down. So Kansas State puts up 55 plus points every week, and they don't have 56 points scored against them. You know, that's a winning formula as far as
you mean. They have a defense chip. They have a little
bit
of a defense.
You know, the thing that I find surprising is look, Notre Dame has done the way it's leapfrogged everybody. Now, granted. You know, for whatever reason, the press just absolutely loves Notre Dame University, and they haven't been in the top 10 in a long time, and everybody wants to see them go. You know, I think they've got a pretty easy job on their hands this week because Pitt goes in to South Bend, and these are lambs being led to the slaughter. You know, I mean, Pitt played a nice game last weekend. I got to give them credit. You know, they dominated a Temple team that they should have dominated. You know,
don't forget, Pitt doesn't win many games and they don't beat many teams, but they do beat number fours this year.
Okay. Well, you know what? I would be cheering for Pitt if they do end up beating Notre Dame. But Notre Dame, I mean, what they did to Oklahoma the other day, it was a pretty solid game, and I can't pronounce the kid's name that's a linebacker for Notre Dame. But he's going to be a first-round pick in the NFL, and he's just all over the place. Yeah. He's involved in almost every play.
He would look good in black and gold.
Well, he's
playing for Gateway.
But one thing about Notre Dame that you cannot ignore, defenses wins championships. I'm a huge Notre Dame fan. That's the tradition of collegiate football. But they have not given up a rushing touchdown the entire season.
They gave up the first one on Saturday night.
That was their first one. You missed
it. They called back, though.
No.
Did they call it back?
No, I believe they did.
No,
score.
They scored.
They scored one. But still, you're 8 or 9 games into the season, they've given up one rushing touchdown. That's an amazing statistic.
It's amazing.
But, you know, that leaves us with the dilemma. There's four undefeated teams, and, you know, since none of them are playing one another, they each run the table, then, you know, what do you do? You know, you've got four teams that are undefeated. Which is more deserving of the chance to make it to the championship game? The BCS is going to determine that.
Wait till next year. They'll have the playoffs next year, the top four teams.
The most likely team actually to lose on the way out is Alabama. Mm-hmm. They've got LSU, and then they've got the SEC championship game.
You know, and you know what I find funny is that, you know, when there was the AFL and the NFL, they coexisted together for 10 years before they merged. I wonder how long it's going to take the SEC and the NFL to merge.
Not going to happen. Not going to happen. I don't want to break your dream.
Speaking of, you guys know I feel that college players, and particularly football players should be getting paid. Did you see the injury to Lattimore, the running back for South Carolina? Was
yes.
that the most
yes.
nasty injury,
terrible injury.
Of all time?
And you know, and, yes. and you know, and that kid that could possibly end his career and his chance at the you know. At the getting the golden egg because he's a junior this year. He's going to be a senior next year.
Yes, Steve Spurrier already said he's coming back for 2014.
He would be a fool to do that. He would be a fool to do that because you know, I mean, he's going to if you're going to get your leg blown up, you may as well get paid millions of dollars to have it happen and instead of doing it.
Let me tell you who will stop it. If somebody decides to go ahead and try to pay college players, who will stop it is the NFL.
Oh, yeah.
The NFL does not want that at all. They don't want to have to compete with Alabama or Michigan to see who can pay these players the most because the NFL doesn't make as much money as the NCAA
true.
Does.
That's true.
Yeah, you got a point there. And, you know, a lot of these college stadiums, you know, they're packing in 110,000 a game. You go up to Happy Valley this past weekend, Ohio State and Penn State were playing. They called it the ineligible because neither one of the teams is eligible for the Big Ten title or a bowl game. And here's Ohio State that's undefeated, who's now ranked in the top 10. They can't do anything. You go to Michigan. They pack 100,000 in there every weekend. And
Texas,
Penn State. You know, most NFL stadiums max out at about 63,000, 64,000.
Right.
So you're looking at 1.5 times the number of people, and that's just amazing.
Speaking of Penn State, what did you think about that call that changed the whole complexion of that game? That holding call that. How was that a holding call? If you guys saw that, I wonder what you guys thought about that. I didn't see a hold there. If anything, he pushed the kid down who was coming at his legs. And then after that, the game changed.
Wow.
Yeah, you know, the referees are supposed to be conspicuous by their absence, but they keep on rearing up their heads and affecting the outcomes of games. You know, you saw that happen yesterday with the Cowboys and the Giants, you know, and the referees called it a touchdown, but you know they reviewed it and correctly they took the touchdown away from the Cowboys. And wasn't it nice looking at the look on Tony Romo's face when he realized he just blew it again?
Yeah. Anybody that leaves Jessica Simpson needs to go down.
I love Jessica Simpson.
You're back in his good graces again.
Well, but, you know, that leads me to another point. You know, you look at the way the Cowboys lost that game yesterday, and, you know, you can blame part of the reason they lost on Jason Garrett. You can blame part of it on Tony Romo, but I really kind of put the blame on Jerry Jones, and he's got the greatest position as all. He's the owner and the general manager,
yes,
so what's he going to do?
Yes,
fire himself from the team that he already owns? He's not going to lose his job, and it certainly isn't going to be his fault, but I don't think Jason Garrett is going to be around a whole lot longer in Dallas because Jerry Jones wants a title, and he's not going to settle for anything less. And and Tony Romo is proving that he's not the guy that's going to lead the Dallas Cowboys to the promised land.
Well, if Jerry Jones won a world championship, if he wants to win a Super Bowl, if he wants to go down in history as the greatest owner since Hallis, then what he had to do is give a blank check to Bill Cowher. Bill Cowher would bring a winner to America's team. Don't forget, it used to be Raider Nation when Bill Cowher took over. After Bill Cowher left, it was Steeler Nation. Bill Cowher turns programs around.
Yeah, the problem that you have with that is that you've got two immensely large egos. That stadium that they built down there is not big enough to hold both of them.
Smoking Jim, the chin will not be in. Okay, that's how simple it is. He got a good gig going on national TV. He fixed up all the spittle. He's not spitting on Dan Marino. He got the teeth fixed and everything else. You got to appreciate that. He's not going anywhere. He'll just tease it around because he'll make a little more money doing his little TV game.
No, I guess I'll just wait for the Hall of Fame.
Somebody may overpay him to come in and try to fix something, but if it's broken, he won't be able to fix it. The only thing that Cowher ever did that Chuck Newell didn't do was lose a Super Bowl. Now you come into a program that Chuck Newell made the best in the history of the game, and he drove it down to the point where they had to lose a Super Bowl. That's unheard of in the history of Pittsburgh Steelers. He loses a Super Bowl, and now it's become a tradition because Tomlin come in and lost one too. I mean, Tomlin is a much superior coach than Cowher ever was. Bill Cowher, I mean, they say he motivated his players. I don't know what he motivated them to do, but the one thing he couldn't do is coach during a game. Right? You watch his career, and it goes like this. Okay? When it's up here, he had like LeBeau and Gailey for coordinators, and he got some other guys, and then he gets them back again. His career goes with his coordinators because he's a garbage coach, and the worst part about his coaching is he had no idea what to do with the clock. He was a terrible clock manager. And you know what? I could call somebody out of the audience, and he'll tell you exactly the same thing.
Well, the one good thing is my main man Chief is out there, and I tell you what, I'm a boxing historian. He brought some pictures in, brought back some memories, man. You watching classic sports, Jersey Joe Walcott, what a great fighter. They wouldn't fight this guy till he was 50 years old. My all-time favorite fighter, the greatest fighter of all time, Rocky Marciano, is in there. Joe Louis is in there. And I tell you what, man, just seeing some of those photos that Chief brought in, I tell you what, man, you guys, the caliber of folks that come to watch us every week is tremendous.
You're saying Marciano was a greater fighter than Ali?
Marciano, what made him great, if you ever study Rocky, is he was he idolized Joe Louis. So what made Rocky great was he did three times what Joe Louis would do. If Joe Louis sparred six rounds a day, he would spar 18 rounds a day. If Joe Louis ran 3 miles a day, he ran 9 miles a day. He tripled everything Joe Louis did and created an opportunity to make himself the greatest of all time. No doubt about it, there's nobody that could beat Rocky Marciano in that era. Today, he would probably have about 15 losses because every time you bleed today, they stop the fights. But if they fought in those same eras, he'd knock everybody out. He would beat you in the arm. You couldn't even hold your arms up after the ninth or tenth round. He just knocked you out.
No, he would start punching you, and he'd start punching you in your arms, and when you dropped him is when he'd knock you out.
Yeah. And but Smoke and Jim, they have technology now where you don't bleed as badly as you did back then.
What happened? No blood?
They can do it now. They can stop bleeding. Look at these guys got scars.
Everything was black and white. Quit donating blood!
Right. Stop donating.
Everything was in black and white.
And then
they didn't see it.
While we're on the subject of boxing, you know, there's one of the greatest trainers in boxing history passed away on Saturday. That was Emmanuel Stewart, and he ran the Kronk Gym in Detroit, and he trained a lot of champions. He trained Evander Holyfield, Tommy the Hitman Hearns, but I believe he passed away on Saturday.
That's right. Yeah, that's
and we'd 68 years old.
Like that.
Well, a couple. Go ahead.
Emmanuel Stewart. He was like extremely knowledgeable about boxing. If you would even watch an HBO boxing show where he was an analyst, Manny Stewart was a great guy to listen to. You could learn a lot just by listening to the fights that he would call. He made his name with the Kronk Gym and Tommy Hearns. Lennox Lewis, in more recently one of the Klitschko brothers. Always managed champions. It's a major loss to the sport of boxing.
Absolutely.
For this guy to be gone.
And another key moment today is it's the anniversary of Cassius Clay winning his first professional fight. It was today, October 29th.
Nobody knows more about black people than Tommy McKee. But one thing about Tom Emmanuel Stewart that people don't realize is a local unknown fighter from here. Now, see, Emmanuel Stewart early in his career got too much credit. Anybody can find fighters in the streets of Detroit, women or men. That's all they do. If you don't have two guns in Detroit, you're underdressed. But as he got better in his career, he came to Manassas, PA, got an unknown left-handed fighter named Michael Moore and made him the first softball heavyweight boxing champ of all time. So we got to give Emmanuel Stewart credit. But early on, here's a little piece of history for you guys. Early on, Emmanuel Stewart had Tommy Hearns, almost like Costamato had Tyson. Didn't let him go to school from about the fifth grade on. And if you ever hear Hearns talk, you know he only got a fourth grade education. But he used to bring him here to Pittsburgh, and he used to fight Ernie Sharif. Ernie Sharif beat Tommy Hearns in an amateur. Ernie Sharif in the Pan American game in Olympic trials for the finals fought Sugar Ray Leonard. And before the fight, he says, if I beat Sugar Ray Leonard, I'll go pro. If I lose the fight, I'll go to law school. He lost the fight just like everybody else did that fought Sugar Ray Leonard, including Tommy Hearns. And now he's a successful lawyer today. Congratulations again, Sugar Ray.
So you're saying Eddie Sharif lost to Ray Leonard for the same reason everybody else did. The Ray Leonard was the most protected, overrated, garbage boxer of all time. And he had more wins that he should not have had. And the guy's the only guy in the world to fight some bum that they dragged in off the street named Donnie Lalonde, beat him for like anybody in this room could have beat him. And they didn't give him one. They gave him two championships in two different weight classes for beating one guy that couldn't fight. Tell me I'm wrong. Tell me that's not the exact truth.
All I know is Sugar Ray was so fast, when he hit the light switch, he was in the bed before the room got dark.
You stole that out of that book I got you.
You give me all kind of black books, I got to learn something.
That was a second baseman in the Negro League, but that's how fast he was. He stole that line. I caught him. He read 17 pages of the book, and that was on number 17. He stopped. You can keep that line.
Now next week, you'll be through page 18.
No, he gave the book back. He's done. He got one good line out
of it. Give me that book on black hockey players.
Okay.
What's that, the Grant Fuhr story?
Yeah. He didn't know, yeah. He couldn't play baseball.
You guys are out of line, so I'm calling an end to this. Thank you very much for watching Level 20 Sportsline. Mike Migliori, Chip Hayner, Smoking Jim Frazier, Alvin the Talking Machine, and our extremely beautiful guest today, Alyssa Doubts. Thank you for coming.
Good luck,
Alyssa,
in the playoffs.
We'll see you next week at Level 20.
I'm John Bauer.
And I'm Ryan Hatcher with Tri-Community South EMS. Did you know after your ambulance emergency, you could receive a bill in the mail, and you may be surprised to find that your insurance provider doesn't cover the full cost? With a subscription through Tri-Community South EMS, you can help yourself as well as your local EMS agency.
Most insurance providers do not cover all costs for an emergency ambulance transport or the patient's copay. The cost of care provided by paramedics and EMTs ranges from $650 to over $1,000. Your $60 subscription, which amounts to little over 16 cents per day, covers all family members of your household as well as guests for emergency medical transport and treatment without transport.
Insurance providers, including Medicare, do not pay for treatment without transport. Your subscription will assure you that you do not have to worry about deductibles or copays, regardless of your insurance coverage.
With a yearly subscription, the costs that come from emergency treatment and transport are never billed to the patient when insurance information is provided. We have agreements in place with surrounding EMS agencies to provide our subscribers with subscription benefits in those areas.
Tri-Community South EMS does not receive tax dollars from the communities that own and operate us. In 2012, the majority of households did not subscribe to our service. Subscriptions help provide revenue to our service, allowing us to provide exceptional care to you and your family.
From the staff of Tri-Community South EMS, we thank you for your support.
Help us in 2013 continue to provide the highest level of care when an emergency takes place by joining our team and subscribing to Tri-Community South EMS. For more information regarding subscriptions or to subscribe online, visit our website, tcsems.org.
If you could do one thing to help prevent 36,000 deaths, help decrease hospitalizations, and the spread of disease, what would it be? Get a flu shot.
Influenza is a serious disease that can lead to hospitalization and sometimes even death.
The flu can affect people differently. Even healthy people can get very sick from the flu, spreading the disease throughout the area.
In 2011, the CDC reported that 20% of the U.S. population contracted the flu, with over 200,000 people being admitted to a hospital for flu-related complications.
By getting a flu vaccine, you can reduce your chances of getting the flu and the possibility of spreading the flu.
When more people get vaccinated against the flu, it decreases the spread of the disease throughout the area, making your community a safer, healthier place to live. Tri-Community South EMS is offering free flu vaccines to adults in our local communities of Bethel Park, South Park, and Upper St. Clair.
So do one thing this year, get a flu shot. It can save your life as well as others.
For information on flu shots, contact Tri-Community South EMS.